That this Assembly encourages schoolchildren to live a healthier lifestyle, acknowledges that following the introduction of a levy on drinks with a high sugar content, an estimated £18 million will be allocated from the Treasury to the Executive's budget in 2018, and calls on the Minister of Finance to ring-fence this money to fund an educational awareness and physical education programme in schools to benefit the long-term health of our children and to ease pressure on the health service.
Gura Margaret, thank you. And I call Carla Lockhart to move the motion.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. I bring this motion today in the hope that we leave a legacy for the children and adults of the future. I want to commend Neil Johnson of the Chest, Heart and Stroke for his very proactive lobby, and would hope that this will get cross-party support. We do not want to look back and see a history of wasted money or missed opportunities. We want to see in this mandate a focus on our children's health. This is a unique opportunity to shape and set in place a programme of healthier living. This £18 million I refer to very clearly comes as new money to this devolved government. It is not costing us anything, but is in essence a windfall from the UK government following the introduction of the sugar tax, or to give it its correct title, the soft drinks industry levy. Under the Barnett formula, we will obtain our share of the tax, which is aimed at producers, not the consumers of soft drinks. A stark fact within Northern Ireland exists that 22% of children are classed as obese or overweight in primary one, which by the time they reach year 8 has risen to 29%. And all the studies show that being overweight is preventable with healthier choices of food that are accessible and affordable and regular physical activity. The reality is that obesity problems manifesting in primary one and upwards are in fact being carried forward into early and later adulthood. The estimated cost of obesity to the Northern Ireland Economy and Health Services Department is around £370 million per year through absence from work and problems with ill health. And I have read that the cost to the health budget represents 3% of their overall spend. My thought on this motion is, surely if we can invest to prevent, it should be a priority for this House. The figure of £18 million has been suggested by one of the Department of Health Obesity Strategy Steering Committee and will potentially reduce year on year, which is welcome because it means that drinks are being reformulated to a healthier combination. This is about penalising the companies who produce drinks with a higher sugar content and ensuring we make best use of this resource to tackle and prevent obesity. There is no doubt that the sole aim of this motion is to garner support and allow for early preparation within the Department of Education for a physical education programme in schools that will allow for increased physical activity at this early age. Currently within schools and within the curriculum, it is suggested that there should be 2 hours of PE education for children aged between 4 and 16. Unfortunately, whilst 2 hours is the suggested amount, many are just getting an average 1 hour per week. The reality is that 36% of children in P1 to P3 get less than 1 hour per week. At this early age, we all know that children are absolutely bubbling to get out of the classroom and use some of their energy, and we all know that bad habits are hard to break. I don't blame this on teachers. I probably blame it on a lack of investment, and I believe that pupil-teacher ratios prevent PE classes for changing purposes. We see some poor facilities, and we also see, I believe, a lack of creativity from our syllabus. I believe we need to see fun activities that will engage these children and young people. We believe this money could be used to expand on initiatives that already are operating. that would ultimately result in a mandatory 2 hours per week physical education programme that help keep their little bodies healthy. No one wants to see their child overweight. Recently, an excellent initiative has been piloted in my own constituency of Upper Bann. It's an innovative and creative programme aimed at getting our primary school children fit and healthy. Healthy Kids has been running for 2 years and has already expanded into 17 local schools. Kevin Creary from Tannockmore Primary School has spearheaded it, and he is on record as saying he was astounded at the societal statistics regarding the inactivity of children, and that as a PE teacher, he decided to do something about it. The statistics also demonstrate clearly that within the UK, Northern Ireland has the least active children. With a group of individuals, Kevin has put together a 16-week physical literacy programme aimed not just at getting kids back to fitness, but to assess their progress with detailed data and video analysis to show just how well the children have done. So far, the project has seen 942 children tested and expected that 2,000 will be tested before Christmas. The aim of this project has 4 strands: professional coaching in schools, the Golden Mile, which enables children twice a week to run round their pitches for 15 minutes, habit building and performance monitoring. From this programme, there has clearly been an increase in children's stamina and speed. It is increasing their participation in competitive sports outside schools, and parents also have noticed their children want to do more outside and to involve themselves in more physical exercise. And we all know that we are in an era of electronic devices, and it's vitally important that we try and engage our children to enjoy the outside world as well. Major studies which have examined this issue find a strong relationship between the amount of PE offered and child's obesity risk and age-justified BMI. In the US, a study found that an extra 60 minutes of PE a week in primary schools lowers a child's age-adjusted BMI score by 10% and reduces their possibility of obesity by 5%. In conclusion, we will actually be supporting the amendment because ultimately it just continues on from what the motion has been calling for. There are a few statistics that I want to leave you with. The University of Ulster research shows that in 2004-2005, only 5% of schools in Scotland offered 2 hours or more of PE. 10 years later, they're currently sitting at a 98% participation now in 2 hours physical education. And the stark contrast is that Northern Ireland has only 8%. The Institute of Chartered Physiotherapists suggests that regular exercise can lead to better concentration, learning skills, and self-esteem. And one major US study found that integrating moderate intensity physical activity into academic lessons in primary school resulted in a 6% increase in performance in standardized academic tests. The benefits of this money being ring-fenced for education is immeasurable, and I have no doubt that it will go a long way to creating a fitter, more active, higher performing generation of young people. I believe that this money, whilst it will come to the finance department, we're giving an educational solution, but it will have immeasurable benefits for the health department in the long run. So we're really cutting across the entire government portfolio, and therefore I would ask people to support the motion. Thank you.
I call Chris Little to move the amendment.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to debate this important matter today and thank the proposers of the motion for bringing it to the Assembly. The issue of child health and physical education and activity is of vital importance. I particularly welcome the opportunity to speak about it today, as it is an issue that I have raised with a number of education ministers over a number of years, and it is clear that we do need to face up to a stark reality that, according to the most recent school omnibus survey, on average only 4% of our primary school children are accessing the Department of Education recommended 2 hours physical education per week in our schools. The debate is of course connected to the wider issue and national scandal that is childhood obesity and overweight. Here in Northern Ireland, 21% of children are classified as overweight and 7% as obese, which, as we've heard, means that 1 in every 4 children in Northern Ireland is either overweight or obese. That has significant costs for the Northern Ireland economy and our health service, and of course all those long-term health issues for our children and young people. I do believe that these are scandalous realities that should be as big a priority for the executive, this assembly, the media and our wider society as any of the issues we face in this assembly. Tackling these problems will, of course, require a multifaceted international, national, regional and partnership approach, of which increased physical activity and taxing excessive sugar and drinks form only part. I think it is worth noting that many people feel that the UK childhood obesity strategy falls far short of what is expected and what Malcolm Clark of the Children's Food Campaign has gone as far to call a truly shocking abdication of the government's duty to secure the health and well-being of our next generation. Others, such as Professor Parveen Kumar of the BMA Science Board, said that the strategy should have included other measures, such as tighter controls on irresponsible marketing and promotion. I think it's important, therefore, that this Assembly and the Executive do consider how we can influence a more robust UK approach and international approach to obesity, as well as the full range of measures that we can take in Northern Ireland to improve the health and well-being of our children. This will need to be a comprehensive approach, and that makes me somewhat cautious with the call for ring fencing of funds for just educational awareness and physical education. There are a range of measures available: improved food labelling, early years nutrition intervention, support for our sports clubs that do tireless voluntary work across our community. And there are a range of departments responsible with various policies as well. Department for Health has the Fitter Future for All strategy, which is the framework for preventing and addressing overweight and obesity in Northern Ireland. The Department of Health and Department of Education Healthy Food in Schools policy, and access to free fruit and veg and greater access to free school meals is something that has been successfully employed in other jurisdictions. The Department for Health, Public Health Agency, and the Department for Infrastructure Cycling Unit has an excellent active travel and safe routes to school programme that is also meritorious of investment. And of course, the Department for Education has its own curriculum sports programme that the IFA and GAA contribute to so ably. So I am somewhat cautious about the call for ring-fenced funding just for education and physical education and just for the Department of Education, but I do assume that the spirit of the call is that these funds will be used wisely and effectively on the focus of the promotion of child health and physical activity, and hence why we're willing to support that aspect of the motion today. And indeed the motion and put forward the amendment. Indeed, the Department for Health Obesity Prevention Strategy, A Fitter Future for All, has set a specific target of every child in Northern Ireland over age 8 having at least 2 hours per week of extracurricular sport, physical recreation or play. So that will be something for us to look at as well. Most pertinent to today's motion is the Department for Education recommendation that all pupils participate in at least 2 hours of PE per week. I have said already that the shocking reality from the figures that we have available to us is that on average only 4% of primary pupils are accessing this recommendation. Furthermore, this is according to a survey, the School Omnibus Survey, which is not, as far as I'm aware, mandatory, and in 2015 was completed by only 36% of grant-aided schools. I think this is a totally unacceptable situation when we're dealing with such a serious issue, and I think it's something that the Education Minister must take extremely seriously. I had hoped that perhaps the Education Minister would have been here today, given how much of these issues do fall across his responsibility, and hopefully it's something that we'll be able to hear from him on at an urgent future date. I think the first step, as set out by the amendment today, is for the executive to accept that it is failing our children and that this is an exceptional problem that will require exceptional action. According to the Chest, Heart and Stroke Organisation, further to the establishment of open, transparent, firm targets and investment in PE support, there are now 98% of Scottish primary schools offering at least 2 hours per week of PE. That's compared with at an average of 4% to 7% in Northern Ireland. So, of course, we need to allocate additional resources. We need to allocate them wisely and effectively. But it's also clear that this Assembly should require significant improvements in the monitoring and the information that's available to us to hold the Executive to account. It is clear that the non-mandatory omnibus survey is not the comprehensive information that we need. In terms of targets, Principal Deputy Speaker, we're often asked for specifics by the Executive. So Chest, Heart and Stroke recommend that by 2021, 70% of primary school pupils should be able to access at least 2 hours of high quality PE each week for all their pupils. We should have a network of specialist PE facilitators, a monitor of all primary schools on the extent to which they have met the 2 hour target, and to report specifically in inspection reports on whether that target is being met. Importantly, and as the proposer of the motion has stated, though, it's absolutely vital that we equip and support our teachers and our schools to meet these important targets, and therefore we should have a PE fund that will award grants and assistance to our primary schools to be able to meet this need. Principal Deputy Speaker, I do believe this is one of the gravest challenges facing our society, and I am proposing that the Education Minister, in partnership with executive colleagues, if helpful, initiates and facilitates a public consultation as to how we properly address this unacceptable situation, how best we utilise and allocate any additional resources we receive, and whether indeed we do need to change what is a failing guideline of 2 hours PE per week per pupil to a statutory obligation. I think this Assembly must show it is willing to get serious in its response to this issue and to fight to improve access to good nutrition, balanced diets and physical activity that our children and young people need and deserve. Thank you.
Éirim Sir Barry McIlduff. I call Barry McIlduff.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I want to begin with a few remarks from the perspective of the Cathaoirleach, or Chairperson of the Committee for Education. I wanted to reflect in this debate that the Committee has not taken a formal position on the issues covered by the motion. So my remarks in this section of my speech, before I make some remarks as a Sinn Féin MLA, are designed to inform the House's understanding of related matters. Physical education, PE, is a compulsory element of the revised curriculum, of course it is, for all pupils from foundation stage, i.e. preschool, to key stage 4, i.e. GCSE. Schools are encouraged to provide at least 2 hours of PE every week. Delivery of all aspects of the curriculum is, however, a matter for schools, and the department doesn't compel schools to require pupils to undertake PE, even if we think they should. The decision on what specific sports or games are offered to pupils and the funding they wish to allocate to chosen sports or games is also a matter for each school. The curriculum sports programme is a DE programme, not unfamiliar to yourself, Principal Deputy Speaker, and it has been in place since 2007, and it's designed to develop the physical literacy skills of our youngest children through participation in enjoyable sports activities, and to help raise children's confidence and self-esteem, and to raise the confidence and skills of primary teachers in delivering physical education. The Gaelic Athletic Association and the Irish Football Association have provided a network of qualified coaches who work with children at foundation stage and key stage one in primary schools. And at one point, there were 61 coaches in 571 primary schools in the north, reaching over 39,000 pupils. That is, 41% of younger children did take part, participated, and those two sporting organisations were leading the way in that sense. Priority was to be given to those schools where children were likely to benefit most from curriculum-linked physical activity, in particular schools in disadvantaged areas. And it's my understanding that the programme cost about $1.3 million per annum. John O'Dowd is going to be my party's next speaker in the course of this debate, and John will make more of the points which I will briefly state now. Sinn Féin feels that the tone and sentiment of this motion is good, is positive, but we do believe that ring-fencing Barnett consequentials through individual motions of this nature is not good budgetary practice. So, Sinn Mamage, thank you.
I call Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on this motion today and commend the proposers for bringing it to the House. In March this year, the then Health Minister, Simon Hamilton, expressed the concern that a levy on sugar-sweetened drinks might simply cause people to switch to other unhealthy foods, with the result that the problem is displaced but not solved. And setting aside his concerns during the final stage of the Health Miscellaneous Bill that this is a regressive tax, is right that the revenue made available as a result of this tax should be utilised to increase public health, and what were a better way to start than with our children. So I agree entirely that funding should be set aside for this purpose, because instilling healthy lifestyle choices in our young people will result in both short and long-term health benefits. We know that eating a balanced diet, taking regular exercise and maintaining a healthy weight can add years to your life and reduce the risk of certain diseases, including cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, obesity, and the list goes on and on. Not only does it bring short-term benefits to the health of our young people, it also delivers skills, knowledge and practice which will live on through generations of our people. If this executive is to get it right when it comes to the health of our young people, it will deliver not only countless benefits to families and public health, but also deliver financial savings by reducing pressure on already over-pressurised health service and the excellent staff. Yes?
Appreciate the member giving way, and appreciate the member bringing the motion here today. And isn't it true that this early intervention and prevention shouldn't just happen in regards to obesity, but right across the health service? Because if we can tackle these issues now, we can make massive savings and save people an awful lot of pain and suffering at the same time.
And the member has an extra minute.
Can I thank the member for his intervention? Absolutely, early intervention is key right across, as you stated. So if this executive is to get it right for the health of our young people, it will deliver countless benefits and reduce the pressure, as I've already said. And can I pay tribute to the excellent staff who work there every single day in our health service? Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I've heard it said many times that your health is your wealth, but I would extend that description to our people's health is Northern Ireland's wealth, and there's a clear and direct link between healthy eating, healthy living and a healthy economy. Last week I had the honour of hosting a writer, cook and friend, Gillie Dugan, as she launched her new initiative, So Grow Munch, in the Long Gallery. This is an inspirational new book and online tool which connects children of all ages with the concept of food growing, food heritage and the importance of buying local produce and how to cook it from scratch. Precisely the sort of initiative we should be encouraging for our children and young people, and can I thank those MLAs who attended and supported Gillie in her launch. However, the breadth of attendance at that event gives a flavour of the organisations whose input is crucial when it comes to encouraging healthier choices amongst children, and I referred to the Public Health Agency, the Food Standards Agency, Belfast Food Network, Northern Ireland Environment Link, Department of Justice, EcoSchools, the Education for Sustainable Development Forum, the Health and Social Care Board, the Ulster Farmers Union and others, to name but a few. So promoting healthier lifestyles amongst our children is not a standalone job for the Education Minister or our Health Minister. If we are to achieve the best results, it must be combined effort across government, but also with input from the private and voluntary sectors. Skills learned at childhood last a lifetime, and the pace of life seems to increase year on year, with quick fix solutions often meaning that healthy lifestyle choices are given less thought than they should be. Choices which then have a longer term consequence for families and indeed for our health service. Less prominence in a child's life and therefore less impact on them physically and indeed mentally. On the flip side, promoting healthier living amongst our people will have longer term positive benefits for families. So again, thank the members for bringing this debate and encourage the Finance Minister to support the concept of an approach to promoting healthier lifestyles amongst our children, which include government, private and the voluntary sectors. Thank you.
Éirim Sir Mark Durkin. I call Mark Durkin.
I'd like to rise in support of the motion and the amendment as health spokesperson for our party. It was actually as health spokesperson I'd been appointed to speak on this, and I actually tried to extricate myself from doing so by arguing this is much wider than the Department of Health issue, and the presence of the Finance Minister here to respond to the debate indicates that the Executive get that, and I think that's to be welcomed. In fact, I think what we have heard here today does demonstrate quite clearly that the key to reducing the massive, the overwhelming pressure on the health system does not lie within the Department of Health. It lies elsewhere, and obviously education has a key role in that, and that's reflected in the motion itself, and it's expanded upon in the amendment. It's quite shocking, and we've heard the statistic quoted here today by Mr Little and by others, that only 4% of children at school here are getting the required amount of physical exercise. And then if we look at what's happening in Scotland, home of the deep fat fried Mars bar and the exercise that they're getting, I think we really do have an awful lot of catching up to do. I know Fra's a big fan. But the benefits of exercise are much more than physical as well, and that doesn't just apply to young people, but it certainly does apply to them in terms of the benefits it has for one's mental health. The things that young people learn while they're involved in sports, particularly team sports, they learn more around social cohesion, they learn how to interact with others, they learn the value of things such as teamwork that are invaluable as they go on in life. The links between... certainly.
Yeah, I'd just like to thank the members for bringing this motion. You may have seen last night on Clareburn Live, Tomás O'Shea, a guy who I had the honour of playing football against, having identified at primary school level the issues around lack of education around diet and lack of exercise, has instigated a programme whereby they're starting to educate the young people about the sugar content of their foods and about the importance of exercise. And it's having tremendous positive effects on the young people, not alone in terms of their health, but in terms of their self-esteem. And yes, the power of sport and exercise in terms of developing kids in terms of their health is enormous, but it's also very positive in terms of developing their self-esteem and their character. Thank you.
The member has an extra minute, but can I remind members that when an intervention is given, it is meant to be a brief intervention.
I might have got more than an extra minute for that one. Yeah, the link between exercise and healthy eating are inextricable, and much has been done in the area of healthy eating in terms of what is available and on offer in schools, and importantly, what isn't available and on offer for young people in schools. And while we have heard, and even the sugar tax might be a case in point, of increasing the price of foods that are deemed unhealthy. I'd like to see us do more work in terms of reducing the price or making more accessible or certainly more affordable, healthier foods for young people. So, some of whom, I know there are young people in my own constituency, maybe 4 or 5 years old, who have never eaten a banana or an apple, and that's actually frightening to think that. But school's only part of the picture, and this is a point that Mr Little made very well, and I think it's also reflected in a briefing that I'd got from John McBride from the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health, that 1 in 5 children in the UK are actually overweight or obese by the time they start school. So obviously there's work to be done with parents through early years programmes. I always say that early years aren't quite Vegas, because whatever happens there doesn't stay there. It carries on throughout life. More needs to be done to educate and empower parents, and we have to recognise that there are challenges for parents bringing up children today, and any parents in the chamber will recognise that the demands on them, the demands from children. Now you have issues where you're competing, the exercise is competing against TV, where you have cartoons on demand. You don't just have them for an hour a day anymore. You have computers and consoles. And also we have to recognise the pressures on children today. And I think we have to be mindful, and there's a lot of talk about obesity and children being overweight, but we're also seeing huge increased pressure on children, boys and girls, to have the perfect body. And we're seeing an increase in the number of young people, again, girls and boys, with eating disorders as a result, and other mental health issues. The importance of physical activity can't be understated. The importance of a healthy and balanced diet is also huge, and we have to do all that we can to ensure that the next generation get both. Schools have a massive role to play. We have to ensure that they get the support to do so. There are also the Sure Start and Early Years programmes that need supported too, and
the member
other
bring his remarks
external
to close.
Sporting and community organisations.
Éireann Sir John O'Dowd. I call John O'Dowd.
thank you, please, Lascan Collier. As my colleague Barry McAdough said, the principles behind this motion are very good. Who could argue against, firstly, a sugar tax? It's a long practice of government as to how they set social agendas. It's either through taxation or legislation. And given the impact that particularly white sugar is having on humanity, then I think it's only right and proper that government try to shape attitudes towards it through taxation. Now, the question arises as to who should have the right to place that tax, and how that tax is raised and how that tax is spent. Now, I firmly argue that such decision should be a matter for the executive in relation to tax-raising powers and tax-varying powers. But, however, the Westminster government has introduced a tax. They're telling the devolved institutions, both here in Scotland and Wales, how that tax will be implemented, how it will be raised, and what level it will be set at. I think it would be then foolish for us to move straight away to, before we know the exact level of revenue that will be raised, the implications of ring-fencing it, to pass an Assembly motion which calls for the ring-fencing of approximately £18 million. Now, I assume that's per annum, but it's quite a significant investment by the executive, and we're going to call for that to be ring-fenced after a 1.5-hour debate. Now, I know there's a lot of research out there behind the benefits of a sugar tax policy, but and there's research also in relation to the benefits of physical education, the benefits of education, and the benefits of a well-educated workforce. And I fully support the principles, and a number of members have addressed this, that it is not solely the responsibility of the health service to look after the health and well-being of citizens. That is the responsibility of the entire executive, because if you have citizens in good jobs, living in good accommodation, in good environments, who have access to leisure activities and are content in their lives, then you, by and large, will have a healthier population than you would otherwise. But if I'm going to be asked to invest £18 million of public funds, or £14 million, or 12 or 10, whatever it turns out to be, in a specific area of our public services, then I want a policy to back it up. They want the research to back up the policy, and then the money should follow all of that. I think we're putting the cart before the horse in these circumstances. And I'm aware, well, firstly, our schools are underfunded because our executive is underfunded, but our schools are currently funded to provide physical education. They also have access to a number of schemes and additional funding from the Department of Education to provide after-schools activities, particularly in socially deprived areas, which can and should promote good health and well-being. So if we're going to add an additional $18 million to that, then I want the policy and research to back that up. But there's a bigger fundamental question here in relation to how we set our budgets. And with respect to the Finance Minister, the Finance Minister sets the budget on behalf of the Executive. The Executive agrees the budget. And we have had much debate in recent months about our programme for government and a new style of programme for government, which should have outcomes. To have outcomes out of your programme for government, you need a budget to back up those outcomes. The programme for government has not been decided upon yet. The consultation is complete, etc. The executive will come forward with a finalised programme for government and present it to this House. So I think the fundamental question then is, why would we set about setting aside a significant, or even bringing in the practice of ring-fencing Barnet consequentials ahead of our programme for government? I think that is, it's the wrong way to do budgets, it's the wrong way to do business.
Thank you, and I appreciate the way in which the member has outlined his position, but I suppose my concern, and I just want to raise this, is the fact that £18 million is not a significant amount of money in the grander scheme of things. I just do not want to see this £18 million go into the ether and for it to disappear. I think it needs to be quite a focused focused activity and programme.
The member will have an extra minute.
I appreciate the intentions behind this motion are good. There's no argument against the intentions of investing a tax which is to combat obesity into the health and well-being of our children. The principle behind it's good, but I will put into context £18 million in this way. £1 million will hire 30 teachers for a year. It will hire approximately 30 nurses for a year. It will hire probably 50 classroom assistants for a year. So what is this? I know when we talk in billions and we get into the habit of talking in billions, millions seem irrelevant. But they do the task when you put them into the right order. So, folks, I fully appreciate the principle behind the motion, the intention of the motion, but I think if we are going to have a programme for government with outcomes, then the budget has to follow the programme for government. And that's the way we should deal with our budgetary processes through the order that are set out and ensure that the outcomes from that programme for government ensure our young people have access to healthy lifestyles.
We now return to the debate on healthier lifestyles for children, and I call Philip Smith. Please.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. 80% of children who are obese between the ages of 10 and 14 will become obese adults, with all the resulting societal impacts. 25% of children in Northern Ireland are classified as overweight or obese, with 21% of girls and 15% of boys overweight, and 7% of both genders obese. According to the Health Survey in Northern Ireland in 2014, there's been no change in these figures since 2005. The Department of Health's A Fitter Future for All has set targets for reducing childhood obesity by 3%, with a 2% reduction in overweight children and obesity by 2022. While there's been marginal improvement in recent years, a target of having 25% of our children as overweight or obese is unacceptable. The number of children classed as obese or overweight is also related to deprivation. The Northern Ireland Social Care Inequalities Monitoring System showed that the number of P1 children classified as obese rose from 3.1% for boys and 4.5% for girls in the least deprived areas to 5% for boys and 6.3% for girls in the most deprived areas. Diet obviously plays a key role, and the National Diet and Nutrition Survey showed that 96% of 11 to 18-year-olds in Northern Ireland did not meet the 5-a-day recommendation for fruit and vegetable consumption. The other key element, of course, is exercise. Northern Ireland schools, as has been said, has a target of providing at least 2 hours of PE per week, yet the NHS recommends at least 60%, 60 minutes of moderate exercise each day for children and young people between the ages of 5 and 18. Less than a quarter of 5 to 12-year-olds in Northern Ireland achieve that target. So we all know that poor diet and lack of exercise amongst children builds up future health problems for the child and, in turn, wider society. We also know that Northern Ireland is especially struggling to improve its performance in these areas. It is welcome that we have the opportunity to invest £18 million in awareness and physical education programmes, and I support the motion in as far as it goes. And it's good to see the DUPs see the value of a publication now they have given control of finance over to Sinn Féin. But frankly, this £18 million is a drop in the ocean. Public health awareness is very much the poor relation, and we fail to invest significant funding in prevention programmes. To provide proper context, let me indulge in a few sums for a moment. There are 1,180 schools in Northern Ireland serving just over 328,000 pupils. That large figure of £18 million becomes just £15,254 per school. In actual fact, it will probably fund a third of a PE teacher, which is good, and I welcome the opportunity this brings. I just seek to put it all in context. What we need, as ever in Northern Ireland, is to be more radical, to set more challenging targets, and to move the bar higher and do it quicker. This is about the future of our children, of our health service, and of our public finances. £18 million is certainly a start, but we need to commit to at least 1 hour's exercise per day for each child, to drastically improve our diets, particularly in our most deprived areas, and at least halve the number of obese and overweight children by 2022. I call on the Health and Education Ministers to use this funding as a stimulus to develop a strategy that will transform our performance on these issues. This is too important an issue to be left to what essentially is a budget that will, by design, reduce as the consumption of sugary drinks falls. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I support the amended motion, but as a first step rather than as a destination.
Éireann Sir Colin McGrath. I call Colin McGrath.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I rise to support this motion by Mr. Deputy Speaker saying we can invest in our manufacturing industry, our economy, our infrastructure and our communities, but fundamentally, if we don't invest in our children, then we have something wrong with our priorities and our finances are simply papering over the cracks. Our children face many obstacles to a healthy lifestyle that we didn't. They have access to sweets, sugary drinks, energy drinks laced with caffeine, crisps, you name it. What was once a preserve for us and once a week and a treat with pocket money is now available to children on tap. And then if you couple this up with the fact that the lifestyle is promoted by IT, smartphones, gaming, social media, again, when we wanted to know something, we had to get out there and get it. We had to go out into the community to kick a football. Now children just have a click of a finger, a roll of a thumb, and they get the information that they need. So we have increased calories intake on the one side and a reduced movement and exercise on the other. And this imbalance is certainly going to lead to problems in the future. What I like, Mr. Deputy Speaker, about this motion is that it isn't about punishing the child. It's not about overt legislation to manage the issue either. It's simply about saying there is a small levy that has been applied to those companies and we want to take that money and apply it into the schools to be able to see if we can encourage young people to get involved in education and fitness programmes to help their health. And we aren't saying either with this motion that we want to reduce the intake or to prevent kids from having the sweeties either. It's just about the levy being used and the finances that are there to help motivate children to move and get exercise. I would ask, though, as ever, and will continue to do so, that some consideration is given to how some of this money might be used within youth services. They have access to over 150,000 young people each year and are ideally placed to be able to work with some young people that schools can't reach. Some of those that don't engage in school or engage in PE at school are happy to engage activities within youth service that could help them. The Royal College of Paediatricians and Child Health in Ireland have written to express their support for this motion and to encourage the Northern Ireland Executive to actively combat the problem of childhood obesity in the north. With 25% of children in Northern Ireland being classified as overweight or obese, Early intervention is crucial if we are to prevent the causes of serious illness. With 1 in 5 children in the UK starting school overweight or obese, and that increasing to 1 in 3 by the age of 11, we need to address health problems and we need to do all that we can to ensure that children are active as they can be. Also, Mr Deputy Speaker, what is shocking is the number of children living in poverty in Northern Ireland. Nearly 1/4 of all children living in Northern Ireland are living in poverty, and that 1/4 of children live in households that cannot afford what is defined as an ordinary living pattern. With a recent study revealing the stark reality of the cost of healthy eating, it is clear that these children from low-income families are the ones that are going to be hit the most. The study reveals that a healthy food basket for a 2-parent, 2-children household costs £115, while a 1-parent, 2-children family needs to spend £99 to eat healthily each week. This equates to nearly half of their weekly income. And Mr Deputy Speaker, it is easier for them to fill up on cheaper junk food than it is to have a healthy lifestyle, and that we are literally trying to kill our children in the long run. I support this motion and any other initiative that helps children and young people to have the best start that they can have in life, the best preparation for their future, but above all, access to a healthy lifestyle.
Okay, I call Robbie Butler. Oh, right. Then I call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. When Carla Lockhart opened the debate, she talked about not wanting to waste money and not wanting to waste an opportunity, and undoubtedly putting £18 million into children's physical education would not be a waste of money. But my fear actually is that it would be a waste of a much bigger opportunity. I've worked a lot around children's issues since I've been in this assembly, and the thing that comes up time and time again is if you want to make a real difference, you invest in early years, something that we have singularly failed to do, previous executives certainly have failed to do. And I think to maybe defend them, to act on their behalf in defence, it's very difficult to take resources out of other aspects of funding for youth services, as Mr McGrath mentioned, or schools or wherever it might be, and say, well, all the evidence actually shows we'll get a better return in the early years. But what we're talking about here is £18 million of new money that we don't have to take from anywhere else, which is why I sought to amend the motion to call for that investment to be put into to early years provision, even before a child enters school. And I think the benefits of that, I think there is a challenge for us. We too often see children as almost as if they exist in schools and all the ills can be addressed through the school system. Children exist before school and they exist before and after school, even when they're of school age. And I think we have to look at better how we support children and families in those circumstances, because otherwise we risk treating the symptom and not the cause. And I think we need to change the families, the communities. We need to support the families in the communities in which these children live and make a real difference. And we've got the evidence there. The work of Professor Heckman has been referenced in a number of debates in this assembly. And he has shown that £1 invested in early years can save £9 investment in later life in terms of tackling social disadvantage, educational achievement and everything that comes with that. One particular programme in Bournemouth where investment was put into under twos, and it helped tackle obesity further down the line. But it also helped improve language ability. It also helped improve educational outcomes. So I think, whilst undoubtedly, if we put £18 million into physical education, it will have benefit. I do believe we can have much more benefit by investing earlier and, in my view, investing more wisely. Also, if we look at the provision of Sure Start in Northern Ireland as an early years service, woefully underfunded. NICFA estimated it would cost £37 million to make that a universal service, as it was before the Tories got hold of it in England. I even think of my own situation as a parent, and in terms of the support we get as a family from our health service. And I don't want to be critical, because I know things are stretched, but when it came to my daughter's review as to whether or not she was able to move on from that health visitor provision, I was about to catch a train and I got an unexpected phone call. And I was asked, I'm your daughter's health visitor, I'm just calling to see if everything's fine. And as I literally was about to buy my train tickets, yeah, she's had a bit of a cold, but things are fine. Oh, well, that's okay, because I'm just looking to sign her off my books. Now, I have no criticism of the health visitor. I suspect she had a caseload quite lengthy, and my family had flagged no problems. But I'd much rather, as a parent, have had properly resourced services that meant I could have had an interview with my health visitor to discuss all the aspects of my daughter's development. So I have sympathy with those who have reservations about ring fencing this money.
And I do believe there are
better ways we can invest to get a better return for children.
I call Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I've listened to the debate this morning and the resumed debate here this afternoon, and I have to say that I found very little in it to object to. I agreed with practically everything that was said by every member who contributed to the debate. I would say, Deputy Speaker, that this has not been an unvarying experience in my time here in the House. It was very, very welcome. I mean, I approve when people say, you know, that it's a disgrace that we lag far behind Scotland, for example, when it comes to timetabled and actual time sort of spent in schools on physical exercise and on sport. That's a disgrace. I agree with everybody who said that, and something should be done about it. Sort of, and all the other various things that have been said. But it does seem to me that when almost everybody can agree with almost everything that has been said, you have to wonder sort of whether there's any sharp-edged points to be made in this debate at all. An awful lot of it seemed to me to be like motherhood and sugar-free apple pie. You know, sort of, which is absolutely fine, except that it doesn't contribute much to deepening our understanding of these matters. It seems to me that we have to look for what is the key variable, sort of at a statistical level, which helps us to understand where childhood obesity comes from. What is it? Is it the colour of our eyes, colour of our hair? Is it the religious community that we come from, colour of our skins? No, it's none of those things. By far, the most decisive aspect, the most decisive factor, is poverty. Overwhelmingly more important than anything else that has been mentioned here today. Every survey shows, Fabian Society survey published just last year, shows that the poorer you are in our society, the more likely are the children of a family to suffer from obesity and from a great number of other things as well. Now, this is true over a whole range of problems that we have in society, of illness and sickness sort of at all ages and so on, cardiac problems, respiratory problems, educational attainment. You take any of those matters, which are frequently debated simply on their own terms in the context of that particular issue. But you look deeply at them, not all that deeply you have to look, and you will discover that income is the most important thing. You only predict, we talk about the chances of people sort of going to university and so forth. Again, the simple fact is that it's the disposable income of the family that you're born into, which overwhelmingly more important than anything else. Of course, yes.
Thank you, and thank you for giving way. I agree to a degree around poverty and the links with obesity, but I have to say I represent a constituency that has both poverty and affluent areas, and I can assure you in the affluent areas there are the same health issues as there is in the areas of poverty.
I take the member's word for it, that that's the experience in her particular constituency. But only two things to her. That the statistics can be misleading at times when you consider them at a constituency level or even at ward level, the wards of local government level. Because you can have constituencies where there's very wealthy people living, absolutely fine, no objection to that, and very poor people living. And depending on the proportion between the one and the other, you will find that the same area can be defined as a doing better than the average economically and can be defined, depending on the way you look at it, as doing less well. But every survey shows that measures sort yes, of differences in
be
income
careful with the
sort of between
there.
Families, every single one. Sorry?
The microphone, Eamon.
Well, am I hitting it, am I? Sorry about that. That everything they want shows that. And there's a couple of specific reasons for it. I mean, one sort of authoritative survey showed that the when we're dealing sort of with a high-value, sort of healthy foods, the price per calorie can be three times as much as junk food, sort of in foods which cost very little. So if you're poor, sort of there's an economic incentive you're pushed towards buying things which fill your children's stomachs and stop them feeling hungry, but at the expense of this being sort of very unhealthy food. So that's one of the factors, and there's many others. But the fact is sort of this, that if we're going to, then you have to ask yourself, if I'm right about that, and all the evidence suggests that I'm right, I mean, not because I understand these things better than anybody else, but look at the statistics, look at the surveys which have been done, and you will see that I'm right sort of in general terms about poverty being the main predictor sort of obesity in children. If I'm right about that, then, Deputy Speaker, if we want to deal with the problem, the things that we have to look at are joblessness, low pay, cuts in benefits. All those things which plunge families deeper into poverty are directly relevant to this particular question. And to illustrate one other a truth, Deputy Speaker, and it is this, that the main divide in our society in relation to this and so much else, the main divide in our society is not between one community and another, it is between the rich and the poor. We are characterised by class differences, not community differences. To that extent, we are not particularly representative here, sort of the community as a whole. Sort of, and I say that it's meaningless to talk about this subject without factoring in the income differences, the class differences between different families. Thanks very much.
Agusnish Iram Sair and Ira Aragadish Hon Fragerha. I call the Minister for Finance to respond.
Kerm, I get a last John Corlia, Ahasram Eventshaw, Latin New Gaharis, Erlan, or Taconor Nagiliga, Stockrock, there in Tiwala, then Woher. Thank you, Alas John Corlia. There is much that is laudable and admirable about the proposal brought forward by Ms. Lockhart and the amendment brought forward by Mr. Little. And in fact, some people might say it's a very sweet deal for the Education Department, but as we have heard from other members, it would be a very bitter blow to communities, to the Economy Department, which deals with jobs, to our friends in the health, and even our friends in infrastructure, who deal with cycling, because if we were to accept the motion or the amendment, we would be accepting that the money that comes by and by from this sugar tax would go only to education. And as I listen to all the members, finishing with Mr. McCann, actually everyone accepts that the solutions to the problems we face around obesity, around ill health, around the access, use and intake of sugar, sugar-fueled drinks and so on, and foods, is a multifaceted problem. We should have a holistic response to it. If I was to accept that I would be able to ring-fence money, which would be a great power to have, I don't actually have that power, but if we were to accept that we should ring-fence money for education, we would be saying that we don't believe there's a role for some of the great work that Mr. Given and communities do in relation to sport promotion, the park runs on a Saturday morning. We would be saying that there's no role here for an intervention by the health department in terms of adults, the different women's groups and community groups we have in places like the Village or the Shankill Road, where people are making real efforts to combat ill health and obesity, if we were to ring fence it to education only. And in terms of infrastructure, we are making progress in relation to the cycling revolution, which Mr. Kennedy, who's not with us, ushered in, but which is continuing, and events like Ciclovia and other efforts to get people on their bikes. So for that reason, I think that the silo mentality going to education only, and I'm not suggesting for a minute that because the DUP hold education that the member suggested should ring-fence the money for education only. And I did say to my colleague John O'Dowd, who was fulsome in opposing the motion, that he would say, he said if he was education minister, he would still have opposed it. I leave members up to make their own minds up in that matter. But certainly, the day of silo mentality, I think, is gone. We are committed to a programme for government, all the parties. No doubt we'll have a good discussion around the final draft that comes out. But we're all committed to an outcomes-based government and strategy. And that means that we will cross-cut against many different departments. So the day for saying that one department alone can resolve societal issues, in my view, is gone. So for those reasons, I am obliged to oppose. Yes, indeed.
Given way, and I very much welcome his assertion that the days of silo mentality have gone, for it will have predated the Minister's time in the Executive, but I do recall the education budget having to be ring-fenced last year, or perhaps the year before, in order for Sinn Féin to support the budget. They would only do so on the proviso that education was ring-fenced.
And I welcome Mr. Durkin's intervention, but it's a matter for the Executive, as you should know as a former member of the Executive, to agree to ring-fencing. I want that power. If anyone here wants to give me the power to ring-fence money on my own, I would accept that readily in the morning, but it's a matter for the Executive. And I don't think this Executive, united in common purpose, is going to agree when we face massive issues like obesity that it should only be one department should get the money to deal with that.
For giving way, notwithstanding what he says in relation to the need for a multi-departmental response to childhood obesity. And I should thank him for coming to the Chamber today. He seems to be breaking a tradition, but he's very welcome. Would he agree that the physical education in schools is clearly a particularly acute problem when, on average, only 4% of pupils, primary pupils, are getting the recommended physical education, that this does need a very strong investment and strong message in response to that particular issue?
Well, I thank the member for his intervention, which may be the last intervention. I'll ask John Corlea, I think that if he listens to his own speech as it went on, and I can quote it back, even he accepts it's not on education alone we should tackle this. But of course it's a serious issue, and that's why we're here today. The other key point is that heretofore we have accepted as an Assembly and as an Executive that Barnet consequentials should not be dedicated to any area before they arrive back. It has been tradition that the money comes back to the centre and the Executive decides how it should be divvied up. And I stand by that principle. I think that is the correct way forward. There's just one other thing. There is a little bit here of, you're talking about my student grant. I would always assume that the grant was coming in. I always assumed it would be more than it was, and then it was always spent within a week when I had planned 3 months of spending. We don't know if there will be £18 million from this. We don't know if there will be £14 million coming in from this sugar tax. So I would say to members to not get too far ahead of ourselves. The sugar tax, I think, is coming in 2018. I noticed an announcement today by Mr. Noonan, it will also come in the same year south of the border. It could be 2019 before revenues come in. So before you spend the entire £18 million, £14 million, £10 million, I think we should just hold our budgetary horses. But I do agree with Mr. McElduff, where he said this is not the correct budgetary approach in relation to Barnet consequentials. If I could refer to some of the points made by members. Mr. McCann makes the point I make, that this is not an issue that can be dealt with by education alone, and he points up the crucial role of jobs, and a point that I think goes without contradiction, that poverty and ill health are linked. Although obesity is a plague on many different sectors of society, but there's no doubt that poverty and ill health are linked. Mr. Agnew, I don't know if he's voting no or not, but he also makes the point, look, this is about families, it's about communities, it's about preschool, and it's about after school and after school age. And I think, again, I'll ask John Corlea, that makes the point that it's much wider, and it would not be wise for us to limit ourselves only to education and tackling this issue. The SDLP health spokes, spokesperson, Mr Durkin, says that the key to reducing pressure on the health system lies elsewhere. And I think that's a very strong point, that we don't spend enough on prevention, we don't have enough strategies, we are too likely to tackle the effects of unhealthy lifestyles than to intervene at an early stage. But that also means our approach must be broader than education. John O'Dowd, my comrade, my colleague, has said that we really need to make sure that if we set the social agenda through taxation, which is what is happening, though it's happening over our heads. I would much rather that we introduced this sugar tax, that we decided how it would be implemented, and then also, of course, as we will decide how it should be spent. But I agree with him that it's a matter for the executive how this tax and levy and dividend should be used in the time ahead. And he did, I think, make a strong point, because it's been repeated by many people here that there isn't enough physical education in schools, but as parents, as grandparents, as people who are involved in our communities, I think we should be going to schools if we think there's a school that they aren't fulfilling the curriculum obligation, rather than just addressing it here. And I know there are some statistics quoted in that. I don't know how accurate they are, but I do see evidence in many schools of very strong physical education elements in the curriculum. Mr Smith made an appeal to the Health Minister and really to us to focus on health interventions and viewed obesity as a health issue. And I don't know if he'll be voting no, but again, that seems to me to be wider than the motion or the amendment, in that you are saying that this should be a first step, which I agree with, rather than a destination. And you do make a point about this being like a sort of a stimulus, and I want to come back to that later on. Mr McGrath says we should invest in our children. I think we all agree with that, and I see in many areas, I see that type of investment going on. Mrs Dobson said that, again, and I'm presuming Mrs Dobson will vote no on this as well, because she said it's not a standalone issue, and I agree with that. It's an effort across government, but yet this motion and the amendment focus just on one area. And I do agree with her when she says that if we can work now with young people, it will add years to their lives, and it will save the health service money later on. Mr McElduff, I think, did something we don't do enough of, which is point to the great work going on. Talked about the IFA and the GAA with their 61 coaches, 571 schools, 39,000 pupils. And we shouldn't lose sight of that as we talk about the problems. We shouldn't lose sight of the great work going on to tackle those problems and to rise to those challenges. And Mr Little, who has the amendment saying it should be ring-fenced for education, says it's a multifaceted problem. So we finish off, and Mr Little made an intervention again, which contradicts, I think, what he said. It's a multifaceted problem, but the solution I'm being told to implement, if I had the power and the authority, is to focus on education only. But I do agree with him when he talks about a fitter future for all, and I do agree with him when he talks about partnership. The last speaker I want to reference is Ms Lockhart herself, who talks about this as new money, talks about it as £18 million. We'll see what it is, but certainly it is, if it's not money from America, hopefully it will be an addition to our budget. What I would suggest, and I would be sympathetic to this, Ms Lockhart, and maybe this can be brought forward, is that we should have an opportunity to discuss in a holistic way how this money could be used to make an impact. So even though we accept, barring a consequence, it's going to the centre, perhaps there could be an initiative fueled by, as Mr Smith says, a stimulus, fueled by this money to make a real step change in our effort to tackle the issue of obesity, especially and obesity in children. And I think that's something that we can return to. I keep an open mind on that. And I would say to members that if they look at other countries, the sugar tax has been used for different purposes. In some countries, it's used actually to help welfare programs. In some countries, it's used to tackle health issues. But I would like us to craft. I would like us to craft how it's used. I wouldn't like just to ape or to follow the lead from other jurisdictions. I think that we could, as an assembly, as an executive, as committees, and there are certainly four committees are interested in this, I think we could bring forward good solutions and good proposals of how this money might be used to tackle the issues that we talked about. And a core, Alaskan core, the core of that is that we want to see our people live healthier lives and enjoy, as Mrs. Dobson said, that your health is your wealth, enjoy healthy lives. So I will be opposing both the motion and amendment, but at the same time I'm sympathetic to the overall thrust of the debate, and I hope we can return to it. And I hope that when we do return to it, I'll have some money in the kitty or in the purse to help deliver the outcomes that people wish to see.
I call on Paula Bradshaw to wind on the amendment, and the member's 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to everybody who's spoken today. I'm actually, for the first time in the chamber, I'm actually not going to read from a speech because I think this debate has been so good and so many important points have been raised. I don't want to repeat them, but I do want to sort of knit them together a bit. I want to come first to the minister's points around ring fencing, and the minister will know as a colleague in South Belfast that I come from the community sector and worked very much in community health projects, and I think it's rather naive to say that the schools would act in silos, because when we look at the after schools programmes, the active communities coaches who went into the schools during the time, the mums and young girls projects, the lads and dads projects. A lot of the times they emanated from the school and they weren't necessarily within the school time. Other people within the chamber today have referenced the, as I say, the after schools programmes, youth clubs and the sports clubs. And again, there is great partnership there between them. The reason why we are looking and we're supporting this motion in terms of going into the schools is because it's a mandatory time that children are there. Not all children go to every sports club. Not every child goes to every Sunday school or, after school programme. So we feel that while the children are in a learning environment, that's where the money should go. And I would reference Stephen Agnew's comments about Sure Start. And while, again, I have great experience of working with them, especially in South Belfast, not all children are eligible for that. And there are children, for example, of asylum seeker families who live in the Lisburn Road, but because of their postcode, they're not eligible to go to their local Sure Start. So don't tell me that. Yes.
I appreciate the member giving way, and just for clarification, my point was about making Sure Start a universal service, as it should be, and hence use the money for that.
You know, I appreciate the point, but my point is that not all children who are probably at the lowest ebb in terms of poverty actually access Sure Start, and that's to do with the structures through which that programme's run out. So again, the schools we feel is the best vehicle for that. Going forward then, in terms of the programme for government, and most of the debate has come from Sinn Féin corner in this, in terms of ring fencing and maybe it's not the right way to go. Our amendment's proposing a consultation process whereby we would inform, we would ask, obviously, we would start with the stakeholders in the schools, the head teachers, and make our way down, but also the parents and the stakeholders in that community to look at a programme through which a structured programme through which children of all ages and backgrounds could access. So I do think that that would provide a comprehensive response to you to inform how this money would be spent. Because as my colleague Chris said today, you know, Alliance are usually very reticent to sign up to ring fencing of any money of this kind because there are other good causes out there. But again, we come back to the schools as the main vehicle for this. The other point I would just like to really end on is has been raised a few times through people, and I think it was really started through Carla's comments about the bubbly children in the school. I thought that was a lovely word to use for children, and you know, they're so full of life, and as we all know, we would call them sponges, for example. So this is really about supporting our children from the start of their educational career. And investing in them as children, but investing in the long-term health and wealth of the nation and in terms of their growth into the future. The other way we would be investing with this 18 million would be through teachers volunteers in the school, leaving resources behind, both in terms of educational resources, but also in terms of footballs and goal nets and stuff like that. A lot of schools, as people will know, are really struggling with their budgets for those things that are probably called luxuries, but they should really be essentials. And then, as I say, then investing in the wider community where there are collaborative projects around. And the last thing I would say is, to go back to the start, whenever I was working in community health projects, you know, we use different venues to educate the young men, especially those who are in danger of educational underachievement. Like, for example, we would have taken them down to Windsor Park and we would have done maths lessons with them with footballs. So this may be about educational and physical activity, but again, it's a wider education process that we would be asking people to engage in. Obviously, it's through health and food and healthy eating and lifestyles and stuff, but I think that the lessons of taking them outside their classroom for 2 hours a week, getting them active, but also getting their minds active too, I think is something we really need to consider. Thank you.
Okay, I call Paula Bradley to wind on the motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to wind in the debate today. And can I first of all thank my colleague, Carla Lockhart, for asking me to countersign this motion today. And can I also thank Chris Little and Paula Bradshaw for the amendment, which we will also be supporting. And I just want to say at the offset, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that from the debate today, it certainly is unanimous that everyone in the chamber wants to support some way of tackling obesity and the problem of childhood, especially obesity within Northern Ireland. But I know we have varying degrees of how we choose to fund that or how we choose to do that, and they may differ slightly, but I do think there's a general consensus within the chamber that this is something that needs to be tackled. Also, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we know that cardiovascular disease and cancer are still two of the largest killers within Northern Ireland, and we also know that both of these are very much determined by obesity also, and also the increased prevalence of type 2 diabetes. We hear that time and time again about the amount of people every year in Northern Ireland that are being diagnosed with this, and again, not all the time, but quite often that also can be attributed to diabetes. I, like others in this debate, believe that in order to reduce this in years to come, we need to tackle not only obesity in children, but also lifestyles in general. And this is where I might get myself into a little bit of trouble here, because I am of that generation where we were encouraged to go out, to go outside and play, to be members of every club there was going. Of course, I arrived here at Stormont and put not only the Stormont stone on, but possibly the Stormont 2 stone on. So I maybe have to, yeah, Carla, I can see that in you. So maybe I need to declare a little bit of an interest there. But as I said, I was certainly of that generation. I was also of that generation where I grew up in a family who had a lifestyle, albeit we were not an affluent family in any way, shape or form. I grew up in a housing estate, but I had a mother who was a wonderful cook, and even worse, she was a wonderful baker. So I was used all of my life to eating healthy, to having healthy food. I can see Mr. Ford laughing in the background. He knows my mother very well from his social work days. And that's how I grew up, and that's how we were. And I believe as a parent that I have shared that experience with my children as well. My children know full well where their food comes. They're quite used to having to go out into my garden and pull garlic up or pull carrots up or pull potatoes up, because that's how I was brought up, and that's how I in turn have brought my children up as well. So I do think there is a greater societal issue as well as an issue to do with physical activity and things like that. I don't intend going on and repeating all the statistics that have been repeated here today. I think they have been well versed, but it is rather stark when we look at the lack of physical activity amongst our children and our grandchildren. I'll just then turn to just some of the comments that have been made, and I'll start off with my colleague, Mrs. Lockhart, and she had talked about a legacy for children and adults for the future. And the aim of this motion was to promote early intervention. And I fully understand that, and I fully think that sometimes we're not always best prepared in here with some of the motions and some of the actions that we bring forward. And sometimes we do need to plan a little earlier and look at that. And she'd also mention that bad habits are hard to break, and so many of these begin in childhood. And we again know that. I know many members have touched upon that here in the chamber. She also spoke about the project in Upper Ban, Healthy kids, and I have to say we had a similar project which ran in Rathcoole Primary School in my own area, where it brought children and parents together. Parents were taught how to cook healthy meals, children were taught where this food came from, and parents and children actually sat down together and ate food together. And for some of those parents and children, that wasn't a regular occurrence, where they sat together and they ate food together. They talked about where the food came from. They talked about the preparation of it. So I can understand that all of those initiatives, albeit they're not the be-all and end-all, but they will form part of a healthier lifestyle here in Northern Ireland. Again, it was a stark again that Northern Ireland, as we have heard, is the least active within the UK. And when we look at all of our sporting greats that we have here, we look at the produce that we develop here in Northern Ireland. Sometimes that's really quite hard to believe. I'll turn my attention over to Mr. Little, and he had mentioned that this was one of the greatest challenges that is facing us in society, and I would have to agree with that. It is something that we see year on year is increasing, and that's certainly something we need to be looking at to address this. And he had also talked about the vital importance of tackling the problem, and it should be multifaceted. And again, that came out time and time again, Mr. Speaker, during the debate, that this is not just an educational issue, this is a cross-departmental issue, and it is multifaceted amongst our community. I thank Mr. McElduck for his contribution, and he had also agreed, as I said earlier, there is a general consensus. He had agreed with the tone and the sentiment of this motion, albeit maybe didn't agree with how we fund that or how we approach that. And I can understand and respect those issues as well. Mrs. Thompson, I believe, made quite a good point, and she said skills and knowledge that will stay with our children into adulthood. And that's, again, that's my experience, that's where I came from, and I think she had the same type of experience as I did growing up as well. And those skills do stay with you, they stay with you for a very long time. And then there's skills that we pass on to our children. So again, societal issues are part of this also that we need to look at. Again, she had touched on the issue about, I don't know if she did or not, but I think I linked it in with that, was to do with how many of our children actually know where their food come from. I know that I have been working along with a couple of our schools again in North Belfast. I can think of one, Abbots Cross, where they have a fruit and vegetable garden, where they have a compost heap. And there's some children that maybe for them, that is actually really important for them, because they're maybe not high academic achievers, but they want to be out, they want to be outside, they want to be working in the garden, they want to be doing those things. So I think all of that needs to be part of our education system as well, where children have those opportunities to be outside in the open air, working and looking at where produce comes from. I think those are all good points as well. I'm conscious of time, so I'll move on to Mr. Turkin, and he raised a good point actually about promoting good mental health through healthy eating, and that also includes the increasing pressures into looking perfect. So I think when we look at the issue of obesity, we also need Mr. Durkin, I think you look nearly perfect, but it's not just obesity that we have to look at. We have to look at the other issues where we have people with eating disorders, and also the issues around emotional and mental health. We know that bullying takes place in our schools. We know that our children are under immense pressure to conform and to be a certain way. And we certainly don't want to see any aspect of this being put upon them, that they have to conform to that way. Also made several points about in his area as well. He had also said that he would believe that there are some people within his own area that have never eaten fresh fruit or vegetables. I would say we could all say that, every one of us here in this chamber, that we have constituents that we know of their children who may not have had that. And that again, that's shame on us as well, because that is something that we need to address and get that learning out there, that what the health benefits are of this, but also how to understand how to use those fruits and vegetables to make something that is appealing for children. And I know as a parent that can often be difficult to do. Mr. O'Dowd, again, he agreed with the principle and the intentions of the motion and said they were very good, though he expressed that it was foolish to ring-fence money, given that we didn't know the amount and that that would be an executive decision. I again understand and respect that point of view, and I know that I would welcome Sinn Féin's general support in this, albeit I know they'll be voting against it, but I do know that they are generally supportive of the principles. Mr. Smith had talked again about obese children becoming obese adults, and that's absolutely correct. It's a hard, hard habit to break, and I think that's where we need to start early, and we need to begin. I'm going to move swiftly through because I know I'm coming to the end of my time, but I know a lot of members came around the same issues. I just want to finish off with just Mr. McCann and the Minister. Well, Mr. McCann stood up and he said that he had listened to the debate and very little to object to. I knew at that stage we were ready for a but. And I'm glad that but came, because I would be of general opinion that he has when it comes to deprivation and health inequalities, because we have seen that time and time again, depending on where you live in Northern Ireland, depending on what your postcode is, that is your outcome of how long you're going to live in life. So I fully understand that. I agree with that. I think there's absolute merit in that. And I do also understand the disposable income issue and how families with a lower income, it can sometimes be cheaper just to go to buy fast food than it is to fill a basket and prepare a fresh meal. So that we certainly need to be looking at that and looking at ways where we can combat that, because there are ways with wiser knowledge of cooking. Just quickly to finish, just on the Minister's point, the motion called for an educational programme. We are not saying that money has to be poured into education. That's not what we're saying. It's not a silo. We're saying every department needs to form part of an educational programme. Thank you.
The question now is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
I think we need tellers. If we clear the lobbies now, the question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Can members resume their seats, please? Right. The question is, order, please. Order, members. The question is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Can I have that again, please?
No.
No. Okay. Right. Can we have the tellers, please? Order. Order, members. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Paula Bradshaw and Chris Little. Tellers for the noes, Jennifer McCann and Kiva Archibald. Clear the lobbies. The assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors, please. Will members resume their seats, please? Members, take their seats, please. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 83 members voted, 61 members voted aye, 22 members voted no. The amendment is therefore agreed.
The question is that the motion, as amended, be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I believe the ayes have it.
No.
No. Noes? Noes? Okay. Okay. Right. So if there's division on it, we clear the lobbies again and the question will be put in 3 minutes. Okay, in order to facilitate this, I've been advised by the party whips, in accordance with Standing Order 27.1AB, that there is agreement that we can dispense with the 3 minutes and move straight to the division. So I now call for the tellers. Do we have tellers, please? Okay, members, tellers are appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Mr. Chris Little and Ms. Paula Bradshaw. Tellers for the noes are Ms. Kiva Archibald and Ms. Jennifer McCann. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Ah! Secure the doors, please. Order. If members would resume their seats, please. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 81 members voted, 58 members voted aye, 23 members voted no. The motion as amended is carried.
The motion then is carried. We now return to the debate on healthier lifestyles for children. And I call Philip Smith, please.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. 80% of children who are obese between the ages of 10 and 14 will become obese adults, with all the resulting societal impacts. 25% of children in Northern Ireland are classified as overweight or obese, with 21% of girls and 15% of boys overweight, and 7% of both genders obese. According to the Health Survey in Northern Ireland in 2014, there's been no change in these figures since 2005. The Department of Health's A Fitter Future for All has set targets for reducing childhood obesity by 3%, with a 2% reduction in overweight children and obesity by 2022. While there's been marginal improvement in recent years, a target of having 25% of our children as overweight or obese is unacceptable. The number of children classed as obese or overweight is also related to deprivation. The Northern Ireland Social Care Inequalities Monitoring System showed that the number of P1 children classified as obese rose from 3.1% for boys and 4.5% for girls in the least deprived areas to 5% for boys and 6.3% for girls in the most deprived areas. Diet obviously plays a key role, and the National Diet and Nutrition Survey showed that 96% of 11 to 18-year-olds in Northern Ireland did not meet the five-a-day recommendation for fruit and vegetable consumption. The other key element, of course, is exercise. Northern Ireland schools, has been said, has a target of providing at least 2 hours of PE per week, yet the NHS recommends at least 60 minutes of moderate exercise each day for children and young people between the ages of 5 and 18. Less than a quarter of 5 to 12-year-olds in Northern Ireland achieve that target. So we all know that poor diet and lack of exercise amongst children builds up future health problems for the child and in turn wider society. We also know that Northern Ireland is especially struggling to improve its performance in these areas. It is welcome that we have the opportunity to invest £18 million in awareness and physical education programmes, and I support the motion in as far as it goes. And it's good to see the DUPs see the value of apothecation now they have given control of finance over to Sinn Féin. But frankly, this £18 million is a drop in the ocean. Public health awareness is very much the poor relation, and we fail to invest significant funding in prevention programmes. To provide proper context, let me indulge in a few sums for a moment. There are 1,180 schools in Northern Ireland serving just over 328,000 pupils. That large figure of $18 million becomes just £15,254 per school. In actual fact, it will probably fund a third of a PE teacher, which is good, and I welcome the opportunity this brings. I just seek to put it all in context. What we need, as ever in Northern Ireland, is to be more radical, to set more challenging targets, and to move the bar higher and do it quicker. This is about the future of our children, of our health service, and of our public finances. $18 million is certainly a start, but we need to commit to at least 1 hour's exercise per day for each child, to drastically improve our diets, particularly in our most deprived areas, and at least halve the number of obese and overweight children by 2022. I call on the Health and Education Ministers to use this funding as a stimulus to develop a strategy that will transform our performance on these issues. This is too important an issue to be left to what essentially is a budget that will, by design, reduce as the consumption of sugary drinks falls. Mr Deputy Speaker, I support the amended motion, but as a first step rather than as a destination.
Eirim, sir. Colin McGrath. I call Colin McGrath.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I rise to support this motion by Mr Deputy Speaker saying we can invest in our manufacturing industry, our economy, our infrastructure and our communities, but fundamentally, if we don't invest in our children, then we have something wrong with our priorities and our finances are simply papering over the cracks. Our children face many obstacles to a healthy lifestyle that we didn't. They have access to sweets, sugary drinks, energy drinks laced with caffeine, crisps, you name it. What was once a preserve for us and once a week and a treat with pocket money is now available to children on tap. And then if you couple this up with the fact that the lifestyle is promoted by IT, smartphones, gaming, social media, again, when we wanted to know something, we had to get out there and get it. We had to go out into the community to kick a football. Now children just have a click of a finger, a roll of a thumb, and they get the information that they need. So we have increased calories intake on the one side and a reduced movement and exercise on the other. And this imbalance is certainly going to lead to problems in the future. And what I like, Mr Deputy Speaker, about this motion is that it isn't about punishing the child. It's not about overt legislation to manage the issue either. It's simply about saying there is a small levy that has been applied to those companies and we want to take that money and apply it into the schools to be able to see if we can encourage young people to get involved in education and fitness programmes to help their health. And we aren't saying either with this motion that we want to reduce the intake or to prevent kids from having the sweeties either. It's just about the levy being used and the finances that are there to help motivate children to move and get exercise. I would ask, though, as ever, and will continue to do so, that some consideration is given to how some of this money might be used within youth services. They have access to over 150,000 young people each year and are ideally placed to be able to work with some young people that schools can't reach. Some of those that don't engage in school or engage in PE at school are happy to engage activities within youth service that could help them. The Royal College of Paediatricians and Child Health in Ireland have written to express their support for this motion and to encourage the Northern Ireland Executive to actively combat the problem of childhood obesity in the north. With 25% of children in Northern Ireland being classified as overweight or obese, early intervention is crucial if we are to prevent the causes of serious illness. With 1 in 5 children in the UK starting school overweight or obese, and that increasing to 1 in 3 by the age of 11, we need to address health problems and we need to do all that we can to ensure that children are active as they can be. Also, Mr Deputy Speaker, what is shocking is the number of children living in poverty in Northern Ireland. Nearly 1/4 of all children living in Northern Ireland are living in poverty, and that 1/4 of children live in households that cannot afford what is defined as an ordinary living pattern. With a recent study revealing the stark reality of the cost of healthy eating, it is clear that these children from low-income families are the ones that are going to be hit the most. The study reveals that a healthy food basket for a two-parent, two-children household costs £115, while a one-parent, two-children family needs to spend £99 to eat healthily each week. This equates to nearly half of their weekly income. And, Mr Deputy Speaker, it is easier for them to fill up on cheaper junk food than it is to have a healthy lifestyle, and that we are literally trying to kill our children in the long run. I support this motion and any other initiative that helps children and young people to have the best start that they can have in life, the best preparation for their future, but above all, access to a healthy lifestyle.
Okay, I call Robbie Butler. Oh, all right. Then I call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. When Carla Lockhart opened the debate, she talked about not wanting to waste money and not wanting to waste an opportunity, and undoubtedly putting £18 million into children's physical education would not be a waste of money. But my fear actually is that it would be a waste of a much bigger opportunity. I've worked a lot around children's issues since I've been in this Assembly, and the thing that comes up time and time again is if you want to make a real difference, you invest in early years, something that we have singularly failed to do, previous executives certainly have failed to do. And I think to maybe defend them, to act on their behalf in defence, it's very difficult to take resources out of other aspects of funding for youth services, as Mr McGrath mentioned, or schools, or wherever it might be, and say, well, all the evidence actually shows we'll get a better return in the early years. But what we're talking about here is £18 million of new money that we don't have to take from anywhere else, which is why I sought to amend the motion to call for that investment to be put into to early years provision, even before a child enters school. And I think the benefits of that, I think there is a challenge for us. We too often see children as almost as if they exist in schools and all the ills can be addressed through the school system. Children exist before school and they exist before and after school, even when they're of school age. And I think we have to look at better how we support children and families in those circumstances, because otherwise we risk treating the symptom and not the cause. And I think we need to change the families, the communities. We need to support the families and the communities in which these children live and make a real difference. And we've got the evidence there. The work of Professor Heckman has been referenced in a number of debates in this Assembly. And he has shown that £1 invested in early years can save £9 investment in later life in terms of tackling social disadvantage, educational achievement, and everything that comes with that. One particular programme in Bournemouth where investment was put into under twos, and it helped tackle obesity further down the line. But it also helped improve language ability. It also helped improve educational outcomes. So I think, whilst undoubtedly, if we put £18 million into physical education, it will have benefit. I do believe we can have much more benefit by investing earlier and, in my view, investing more wisely. Also, if we look at the provision of Sure Start in Northern Ireland as an early years service, woefully underfunded. NICFA estimated it would cost £37 million to make that a universal service as it was before the Tories got hold of it in England. I even think of my own situation as a parent, and in terms of the support we get as a family from our health service, and I don't want to be critical because I know things are stretched, but when it came to my daughter's review as to whether or not she was able to move on from that health visitor provision, I was about to catch a train and I got an unexpected phone call. And I was asked, I'm your daughter's health visitor, I'm just calling to see if everything's fine. And as I literally was about to buy my train tickets, yeah, she's had a bit of a cold, but things are fine. Oh, well, that's okay, because I'm just looking to sign her off my books. Now, I have no criticism of the health visitor. I suspect she had a caseload quite lengthy, and my family had flagged no problems. But I'd much rather, as a parent, have had properly resourced services that meant I could have had an interview with my health visitor to discuss all the aspects of my daughter's development. So I have sympathy with those who have reservations about ring-fencing this money. And,
would the member draw his remarks to a close,
there are
please.
Better ways we can invest to get a better return for children.
I call Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I've listened to the debate this morning and the resumed debate here this afternoon, and I have to say that I found very little in it to object to. I agreed with practically everything that was said by every member who contributed to the debate. I would say, Deputy Speaker, that this has not been an unvarying experience in my time here in the House. It was very, very welcome. I mean, I approve when people say, you know, that it's a disgrace that we lag far behind Scotland, for example, when it comes to timetabled and actual time sort of spent in schools on physical exercise and on sport. That's a disgrace. I agree with everybody who said that, and something should be done about it. Sort of, and all the other various things that have been said. But it does seem to me that when almost everybody can agree with almost everything that has been said, you have to wonder sort of whether there's any sharp-edged points to be made in this debate at all. An awful lot of it seemed to me to be like motherhood and sugar-free apple pie. You know, sort of, which is absolutely fine, except that it doesn't contribute much to deepening our understanding of these matters. It seems to me that we have to look for what is the key variable, sort of at a statistical level, which helps us to understand where childhood obesity comes from. What is it? Is it the colour of our eyes, colour of our hair? Is it the religious community that we come from, colour of our skins? No, it's none of those things. By far, the most decisive aspect, the most decisive factor, is poverty. Overwhelmingly more important than anything else that has been mentioned here today. Every survey shows, Fabian Society survey published just last year, shows that the poorer you are in our society, the more likely are the children of a family to suffer from obesity and from a great number of other things as well. Now, this is true over a whole range of problems that we have in society, of illness and sickness sort of at all ages and so on, cardiac problems, respiratory problems, educational attainment. You take any of those matters, which are frequently debated simply on their own terms in the context of that particular issue, but you look deeply at them, not all that deeply you have to look, and you will discover that income is the most important thing. You want to predict, we talk about the chances of people sort of going to university and so forth. Again, the simple fact is that it's the disposable income of the family that you're born into, which overwhelmingly more important than anything else. Of course, yes.
Thank you, and thank you for giving way. I agree to a degree around poverty and the links with obesity, but I have to say I represent a constituency that has both poverty and affluent areas, and I can assure you in the affluent areas there are the same health issues as there is in the areas of poverty.
Well, I take the member's word for it that that's the experience in her particular constituency. One of two things to her. That the statistics can be misleading at times when you consider them at a constituency level or even at ward level, that is, wards at local government level. Because you can have constituencies where there's very wealthy people living, absolutely fine, no objection, and very poor people living. And depending on the proportion between the one and the other, you will find that the same area can be defined as a doing better than the average economically and can be defined, depending on the way you look at it, as doing less well. But every survey shows that measures sort
yes,
of could differences
the member
in
be
income
careful with the
sort of between
there.
Families, every single one. Sorry?
The microphone, Eamon.
Well, I'm hitting it, am I? Sorry about that. That everything shows that. And there's a couple of specific reasons for it. I mean, one sort of authoritative survey showed that the when we're dealing sort of with a high value sort of healthy foods, the price per calorie can be three times as much as junk food, sort of, and foods which cost very little. So if you're poor, sort of, there's an economic incentive you're pushed towards buying things which fill your children's stomachs and stop them feeling hungry, but at the expense of this being sort of a very unhealthy food. So that's one of the factors, and there's many others. But the fact is sort of this, that if we're going to, then you have to ask yourself, if I'm right about that, and all the evidence suggests that I'm right, I mean, not because I understand these things better than anybody else, but look at the statistics, look at the surveys which have been done, and you will see that I'm right sort of in general terms about poverty being the main predictor sort of obesity in children. If I'm right about that, then, Deputy Speaker, if we want to deal with the problem, the things that we have to look at are joblessness, low pay, cuts in benefits. All those things which plunge families deeper into poverty are directly relevant to this particular question. And the illustrate one other a truth, Deputy Speaker, and it is this, that the main divide in our society in relation to this and so much else, the main divide in our society is not between one community and another, it is between the rich and the poor. We are characterised by class differences, not community differences. To that extent, we are not particularly representative here, sort of the community as a whole. Sort of, and I say that it's meaningless to talk about this subject without factoring in the income differences, the class differences between different families. Thanks very much.
Agusnish Iram Sir and Ira Argadish Hon Fragerha. I call the Minister for Finance to respond.
Kerm, I get a last John Corlia, Ahasram Eventshaw, Latin New Gaharish, Erlan, or Takan Nagiliga, Stockrock, there in Tiwala, then Woher. Thank you, Alas John Corlia. There is much that is laudable and admirable about the proposal brought forward by Ms. Lockhart and the amendment brought forward by Mr. Little. And in fact, some people might say it's a very sweet deal for the Education Department, but as we have heard from other members, it would be a very bitter blow to communities, to the Economy Department, which deals with jobs, to our friends in the health, and even our friends in infrastructure who deal with cycling, because if we were to accept the motion or the amendment, we would be accepting that the money that comes by and by from this sugar tax would go only to education. And as I listen to all the members, finishing with Mr. McCann, actually everyone accepts that the solutions to the problems we face around obesity, around ill health, around the access, use and intake of sugar, sugar-fueled drinks and so on, and foods, is a multifaceted problem. We should have a holistic response to it. If I was to accept that I would be able to ring-fence money, which would be a great power to have, I don't actually have that power, but if we were to accept that we should ring-fence money for education, we would be saying that we don't believe there's a role for some of the great work that Mr. Given and communities do in relation to sport promotion, the park runs on a Saturday morning. We would be saying that there's no role here for an intervention by the health department in terms of adults, the different women's groups and community groups we have in places like the Village or the Shankill Road, where people are making real efforts to combat ill health and obesity, if we were to ring-fence it to education only. And in terms of infrastructure, we are making progress in relation to the cycling revolution, which Mr. Kennedy, who's not with us, ushered in, but which is continuing, and events like Ciclovia and other efforts to get people on their bikes. So for that reason, I think that the silo mentality going to education only, and I'm not suggesting for a minute that because the DUP hold education that the member suggested she'd ring-fence the money for education only. And I did say to my colleague John O'Dowd, who was fulsome in opposing the motion, that he said if he was education minister, he would still have opposed it. I leave members up to make their own minds up in that matter. But certainly, the day of silo mentality, I think, is gone. We are committed to a programme for government. All the parties, no doubt, we'll have a good discussion around the next draft, the final draft that comes out. But we're all committed to an outcomes-based government and strategy, and that means that we will cross-cut against many different departments. So the day for saying that one department alone can resolve societal issues, in my view, is gone. So for those reasons, I am obliged to Oppose? Yes, indeed.
Given way, and I very much welcome his assertion that the days of silo mentality have gone, for it will have predated the Minister's time in the Executive, but I do recall the education budget having to be ring-fenced last year, or perhaps the year before, in order for Sinn Féin to support the budget. They would only do so on the proviso that education was ring-fenced.
And I welcome Mr. Durkin's intervention, but it's a matter for the Executive, as you should know as a former member of the Executive, to agree to ring-fencing. I want that power. If anyone here wants to give me the power to ring-fence money on my own, I will accept that readily in the morning. But it's a matter for the Executive. And I don't think this Executive, united in common purpose, is going to agree when we face massive issues like obesity that it should only be one department that should get the money to deal with that.
Thank you, Mr. For giving way, notwithstanding what he says in relation to the need for a multi-departmental response to childhood obesity. And I should thank him for coming to the Chamber today. He seems to be breaking a tradition, but he's very welcome. Would he agree that the physical education in schools is clearly a particularly acute problem when, on average, only 4% of pupils, primary pupils, are getting the recommended physical education, that this does need a very strong investment and strong message in response to that particular issue?
Well, I thank the member for his intervention, which may be the last intervention. I'll ask John Corlea. I think that if he listens to his own speech as it went on, and I can quote it back, even he accepts it's not on education alone we should tackle this. But of course it's a serious issue, and that's why we're here today. The other key point is that heretofore we have accepted as an Assembly and as an Executive that Barnet consequentials should not be dedicated to any area before they arrive back. It has been tradition that the money comes back to the centre and the Executive decides how it should be divvied up. And I stand by that principle. I think that is the correct way forward. There's just one other thing. There is a little bit here of, you talk about my student grant. I would always assume that the grant was coming in. I always assumed it would be more than it was. And then it was always spent within a week when I had planned 3 months of spending. We don't know if there would be £18 million from this. We don't know if there would be £14 million coming in from this sugar tax. So I would say to members to not get too far ahead of ourselves. The sugar tax, I think, is coming in 2018. I noticed an announcement today by Mr. Noonan it will also come in the same year south of the border. It could be 2019 before revenues come in. So before you spend the entire £18 million, £14 million, £10 million, I think we should just hold our budgetary horses. But I do agree with Mr. McElduff, where he said this is not the correct budgetary approach in relation to Barnet consequentials. If I could refer to some of the points made by members. Mr. McCann makes the point I make, that this is not an issue that can be dealt with by education alone, and he points up the crucial role of jobs, and a point that I think goes without contradiction, that poverty and ill health are linked, although obesity is a plague on many different sectors of society, but there's no doubt that poverty and ill health are linked. Mr. Agnew, I don't know if he's voting no or not, but he also makes the point, look, this is about families, it's about communities, it's about preschool, it's about after school and after school age. And I think, again, I'll ask John Corlea, that makes the point that it's much wider, and it would not be wise for us to limit ourselves only to education and tackling this issue. The SDLP health spokesperson, Mr. Durkin, says that the key to reducing pressure on the health system lies elsewhere, and I think that's a very strong point, that we don't spend enough on prevention, we don't have enough strategies, we are too likely to tackle the effects of unhealthy lifestyles than to intervene at an early stage. But that also means our approach must be broader than education. John O'Dowd, my colleague, has said that we really need to make sure that if we set the social agenda through taxation, which is what is happening, or what's happening over our heads, I would much rather that we introduce this sugar tax, that we decided how it would be implemented, and then also, of course, as we will decide how it should be spent. But I agree with him that it's a matter for the Executive how this tax and levy and dividend should be used in the time ahead. And he did, I think, make a strong point, because it's been repeated by many people here that there isn't enough physical education in schools. But as parents, as grandparents, as people who are involved in our communities, I think we should be going to schools if we think there's a school that they aren't fulfilling the curriculum obligation, rather than just addressing it here. And I know there are some statistics quoted in that. I don't know how accurate they are, but I do see evidence in many schools of very strong physical education elements in the curriculum. Mr. Smith made an appeal to the Health Minister and really to us to focus on health interventions and viewed obesity as a health issue. And I don't know if he'll be voting no, but again, that seems to me to be wider than the motion or the amendment, in that you are saying that this should be a first step, which I agree with, rather than a destination. And you do make a point about this being like a sort of a stimulus, and I want to come back to that later on. Mr. McGrath says we should invest in our children. I think we all agree with that, and I see, again, I see in many areas, I see that type of investment going on. Mrs. Dobson said that, again, and I'm presuming Mrs. Dobson will vote no on this as well, because she said it's not a standalone issue, and I agree with that. It's an effort across government, but yet this motion and the amendment focus just on one area. And I do agree with her when she says that if we can work now with young people, it will add years to their lives and it will save the health service money later on. Mr. McElduff, I think, did something we don't do enough of, which is point to the great work going on. Talked about the IFA and the GAA with their 61 coaches, 571 schools, 39,000 pupils. And we shouldn't lose sight of that as we talk about the problems. We shouldn't lose sight of the great work going on to tackle those problems and to rise to those challenges. And Mr. Little, who has the amendment saying it should be ring-fenced for education, says it's a multifaceted problem. So we finish off, and Mr. Little made an intervention again, which contradicts, I think, what he said. It's a multifaceted problem, but the solution I'm being told to implement, if I had the power and the authority, is to focus on education only. But I do agree with him when he talks about a fitter future for all, and I do agree with him when he talks about partnership. The last speaker I want to reference is Ms. Lockhart herself, who talks about this as new money, talks about it as £18 million. We'll see what it is, but certainly it is, if it's not money from America, hopefully it will be an addition to our budget. What I would suggest, and I would be sympathetic to this, Ms. Lockhart, and maybe this can be brought forward, is that we should have an opportunity to discuss in a holistic way how this money could be used to make an impact. So even though we accept Barnett consequences going to the centre, perhaps there could be an initiative fueled by, as Mr. Smith says, a stimulus, fueled by this money to make a real step change in our effort to tackle the issue of obesity, especially and obesity in children. And I think that's something that we can return to. I keep an open mind on that, and I would say to members that if they look at other countries, the sugar tax has been used for different purposes. In some countries, it's used actually to help welfare programs. In some countries, it's used to tackle health issues. But I would like us to craft. I would like us to craft how it's used. I wouldn't like just to ape or to follow the lead from other jurisdictions. I think that we could, as an assembly, as an executive, as committees, and there are certainly four committees are interested in this, I think we could bring forward good solutions and good proposals of how this money might be used to tackle the issues that we talked about. And a core that is that we want to see our people live healthier lives and enjoy, as Mrs. Dobson said, that your health is your wealth, enjoy healthy lives. So I will be opposing both the motion and amendment, but at the same time I'm sympathetic to the overall thrust of the debate, and I hope we can return to it. And I hope that when we do return to it, I'll have some money in the kitty or in the purse to help deliver the outcomes that people wish to see. Go to Mohegan.
I call on Paula Bradshaw to wind on the amendment, and the member's 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to everybody who's spoken today. I'm actually, for the first time in the chamber, I'm actually not going to read from a speech because I think this debate has been so good and so many important points have been raised. I don't want to repeat them, but I do want to sort of knit them together a bit. I want to come first to the minister's points around ring fencing, and the minister will know, as a colleague in South Belfast, that I come from the community sector and worked very much in community health projects. And I think it's rather naive to say that the schools would act in silos, because when we look at the after schools programmes, the active communities, coaches who went into the schools during the time, the mums and young girls projects, the lads and dads projects, a lot of the times they emanated from the school and they weren't necessarily within the school time. Other people within the chamber today have referenced the, as I say, the after schools programmes, youth clubs and the sports clubs. And again, there is great partnership there between them. The reason why we are looking and we're supporting this motion in terms of going into the schools is because it's a mandatory time that children are there. Not all children go to every sports club. Not every child goes to every Sunday school or, after school programme. So we feel that while the children are in a learning environment, that's where the money should go. And I would reference Stephen Agnew's comments about Sure Start. And while, again, I have great experience of working with them, especially in South Belfast, not all children are eligible for that. And there are children, for example, of asylum seeker families who live on the Lisburn Road, but because of their postcode, they're not eligible to go to their local Sure Start. So don't tell me that. Yes.
I appreciate the member giving way, and just for clarification, my point was about making Sure Start a universal service, as it should be, and hence use the money for that.
You know, I appreciate the point, but my point is that not all children who are probably at the lowest ebb in terms of poverty actually access Sure Start, and that's to do with the structures through which that programme's run out. So again, the schools we feel is the best vehicle for that. Going forward then, in terms of the programme for government, and most of the debate has come from Sinn Féin corner in this, in terms of ring fencing and maybe it's not the right way to go. Our amendment's proposing a consultation process whereby we would inform, we would ask, obviously, we would start with the stakeholders in the schools, the head teachers, and make our way down, but also the parents and the stakeholders in that community to look at a programme through which, a structured programme through which children of all ages and backgrounds could access. So I do think that that would provide a comprehensive response to you to inform how this money would be spent. Because as my colleague Chris said today, you know, Alliance are usually very reticent to sign up to ring fencing of any money of this kind, because there are other good causes out there. But again, we come back to the schools as the main vehicle for this. The other point I would just like to really end on is has been raised a few times through people, and I think it was really started through Carla's comments about the bubbly children in the school. I thought that was a lovely word to use for children, and you know, they're so full of life, and as we all know, we would call them sponges, for example. So this is really about supporting our children from the start of their educational career. And investing in them as children, but investing in the long-term health and wealth of the nation and in terms of their growth into the future. The other way we would be investing with this $18 million would be through teachers, volunteers in the school, leaving resources behind, both in terms of educational resources, but also in terms of footballs and goal nets and stuff like that. A lot of schools, as people will know, are really struggling with their budgets for those things that are probably called luxuries, but they should really be essentials. And then, as I say, then investing in the wider community where there are collaborative projects around. And the last thing I would say is, to go back to the start, whenever I was working in community health projects, you know, we use different venues to educate the young men, especially those who are in danger of educational underachievement. Like, for example, we would have taken them down to Windsor Park and we would have done maths lessons with them with footballs. So this may be about educational and physical activity, but again, it's a wider education process that we would be asking people to engage in. Obviously, it's through health and food and healthy eating and lifestyles and stuff, but I think that the lessons of taking them outside their classroom for 2 hours a week, getting them active, but also getting their minds active too, I think is something we really need to consider. Thank you.
Okay, I call Paula Bradley to wind on the motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to wind in the debate today. And can I first of all thank my colleague, Carla Lockhart, for asking me to countersign this motion today. And can I also thank Chris Little and Paula Bradshaw for the amendment, which we will also be supporting. And I just wanted to say at the offset, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that from the debate today, it certainly is unanimous that everyone in the chamber wants to support some way of tackling obesity and the problem of childhood, especially obesity within Northern Ireland. But I know we have varying degrees of how we choose to fund that or how we choose to do that, and they may differ slightly, but I do think there's a general consensus within the chamber that this is something that needs to be tackled. Also, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we know that cardiovascular disease and cancer are still two of the largest killers within Northern Ireland, and we also know that both of these are very much determined by obesity also, and also the increased prevalence of type 2 diabetes. We hear that time and time again about the amount of people every year in Northern Ireland that are being diagnosed with this, and again, not all the time, but quite often that also can be attributed to diabetes. I, like others in this debate, believe that in order to reduce this in years to come, we need to tackle not only obesity in children, but also lifestyles in general. And this is where I might get myself into a little bit of trouble here, because I am of that generation where we were encouraged to go out, to go outside and play, to be members of every club there was going. Of course, I arrived here at Stormont and put not only the Stormont stone on, but possibly the Stormont 2 stone on. So I maybe have to, yeah, Carla, I can see that in you. So maybe I need to declare a little bit of an interest there. But as I said, I was certainly of that generation. I was also of that generation where I grew up in a family who had a lifestyle, albeit we were not an affluent family in any way, shape or form. I grew up in a housing estate, but I had a mother who was a wonderful cook, and even worse, she was a wonderful baker. So I was used all of my life to eating healthy, to having healthy food. I can see Mr. Ford laughing in the background. He knows my mother very well from his social work days. And that's how I grew up, and that's how we were. And I believe as a parent that I have shared that experience with my children as well. My children know full well where their food comes. They're quite used to having to go out into my garden and pull garlic up or pull carrots up or pull potatoes up, because that's how I was brought up, and that's how I in turn have brought my children up as well. So I do think there is a greater societal issue as well as an issue to do with physical activity and things like that. I don't intend going on and repeating all the statistics that have been repeated here today. I think they have been well versed, but it is rather stark when we look at the lack of physical activity amongst our children and our grandchildren. I'll just then turn to just some of the comments that have been made, and I'll start off with my colleague, Mrs. Lockhart, and she had talked about a legacy for children and adults for the future. And the aim of this motion was to promote early intervention. And I fully understand that, and I fully think that sometimes we're not always best prepared in here with some of the motions and some of the actions that we bring forward. And sometimes we do need to plan a little earlier and look at that. And she'd also mention that bad habits are hard to break, and so many of these begin in childhood. And we again know that. I know many members have touched upon that here in the chamber. She also spoke about the project in Upper Ban, Healthy Kids. And I have to say, we had a similar project which ran in Rathcoole Primary School in my own area, where it brought children and parents together. Parents were taught how to cook healthy meals. Children were taught where this food came from. And parents and children actually sat down together and ate food together. And for some of those parents and children, that wasn't a regular occurrence, where they sat together and they ate food together. They talked about where the food came from. They talked about the preparation of it. So I can understand that all of those initiatives, albeit they're not the be-all and end-all, but they will form part of a healthier lifestyle here in Northern Ireland. Again, it was stark again that Northern Ireland, as we have heard, is the least active within the UK. And when we look at all of our sporting greats that we have here, we look at the produce that we develop here in Northern Ireland. Sometimes that's really quite hard to believe. I'll turn my attention over to Mr. Little. And he had mentioned that this was one of the greatest challenges that is facing us in society. And I would have to agree with that. It is something that we see year on year is increasing, and that's certainly something we need to be looking at to address this. And he had also talked about the vital importance of tackling the problem, and it should be multifaceted. And again, that came out time and time again, Mr. Speaker, during the debate, that this is not just an educational issue, this is a cross-departmental issue, and it is multifaceted amongst our community. I thank Mr. McElduck for his contribution, and he had also agreed, as I said earlier, there is a general consensus. He had agreed with the tone and the sentiment of this motion, albeit maybe didn't agree with how we fund that or how we approach that. And I can understand and respect those issues as well. Mrs. Thompson, I believe, made a really quite a good point, and she said skills and knowledge that will stay with our children into adulthood. And that's, again, that's my experience, that's where I came from, and I think she had the same type of experience as I did growing up as well. And those skills do stay with you, they stay with you for a very long time. And then there's skills that we pass on to our children. So again, societal issues are part of this also that we need to look at. Again, she had touched on the issue about, I don't know if she did or not, but I think I linked it in with that, was to do with how many of our children actually know where their food comes from. I know that I have been working along with a couple of our schools again in North Belfast. I can think of one, Abbots Cross, where they have a fruit and vegetable garden, where they have a compost heap. And there's some children that maybe for them, that is actually really important for them, because they're maybe not high academic achievers, but they want to be out, they want to be outside, they want to be working in the garden, they want to be doing those things. So I think all of that needs to be part of our education system as well, where children have those opportunities to be outside in the open air, working and looking at where produce comes from. I think those are all good points as well. I'm conscious of time, so I'll move on to Mr. Turkin, and he raised a good point actually about promoting good mental health through healthy eating, and that also includes the increasing pressures into looking perfect. So I think when we look at the issue of obesity, we also need, Mr. Durkin, I think you look nearly perfect, but that it's not just obesity that we have to look at, we have to look at the other issues where we have people with eating disorders, and also the issues around emotional and mental health. We know that bullying takes place in our schools, we know that our children are under immense pressure to conform and to be a certain way, and we certainly don't want to see any aspect of this being put upon them that they have to conform to that way. Also made several points about in his area as well. He had also said that he would believe that there are some people within his own area that have never eaten fresh fruit or vegetables. I would say we could all say that, every one of us here in this chamber, that we have constituents that we know of their children who may not have had that. And that again, that's shame on us as well, because that is something that we need to address and get that learning out there, that what the health benefits are of this, but also how to understand how to use those fruits and vegetables to make something that is appealing for children. And I know as a parent that can often be difficult to do. Mr. O'Dowd, again, he agreed with the principle and the intentions of the motion and said they were very good, though he expressed that it was foolish to ring fence money, given that we didn't know the amount and that would be an executive decision. I again understand and respect that point of view, and I know that I would welcome Sinn Féin's general support in this, albeit I know they'll be voting against it, but I do know that they are generally supportive of the principles. Mr. Smith had talked again about obese children becoming obese adults, and that's absolutely correct. It's a hard, hard habit to break, and I think that's where we need to start early, and we need to begin. I'm going to move swiftly through because I know I'm coming to the end of my time, but I know a lot of members came around the same issues. I just want to finish off with just Mr. McCann and the Minister. When Mr. McCann stood up and he said that he had listened to the debate and very little to object to, I knew at that stage we were ready for a but. And I'm glad that but came, because I would be of general opinion that he has when it comes to deprivation and health inequalities, because we have seen that time and time again, dependent on where you live in Northern Ireland, dependent on what your postcode is, that is your outcome of how long you're going to live in life. So I fully understand that. I agree with that. I think there's absolute merit in that. And I do also understand the disposable income issue and how families with a lower income, it can sometimes be cheaper just to go to buy fast food than it is to fill a basket and prepare a fresh meal. So that we certainly need to be looking at that and looking at ways where we can combat that, because there are ways with wiser knowledge of cooking. Just quickly to finish, just on the Minister's point, the motion called for an educational programme. We are not saying that money has to be poured into education. That's not what we're saying. It's not a silo. We're saying every department need to form part of an educational programme. Thank you.
The question now is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
I think we need tellers. If we clear the lobbies now, the question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Can members resume their seats, please? Right. The question is, order, please. Order, members. The question is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
Can I have that again, please?
No.
No. Okay. Right. Can we have the tellers, please? Order. Order, members. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Paula Bradshaw and Chris Little. Tellers for the noes, Jennifer McCann and Kiva Archibald. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors, please. Will members resume their seats, please? Members take their seats, please. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 83 members voted, 61 members voted aye, 22 members voted no. The amendment is therefore agreed.
The question is that the motion, as amended, be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I believe the ayes have it.
No.
No. Noes? Noes? Okay. Okay. Right. So if there's division on it, we clear the lobbies again, and the question will be put in 3 minutes. Okay, in order to facilitate this, I've been advised by the party whips, in accordance with Standing Order 27.1AB, that there's agreement that we can dispense with the 3 minutes and move straight to the division. So I now call for the tellers. Do we have tellers, please? Okay, members, tellers are appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Mr. Chris Little and Ms. Paula Bradshaw. Tellers for the noes are Ms. Kiva Archibald and Ms. Jennifer McCann. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left.
Ah!
Secure the doors, please. Order. If members would resume their seats, please. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 81 members voted, 58 members voted aye, 23 members voted no. The motion as amended is carried.
The motion then is carried.